Good evening, class. So for today, we will have a discussion of liabilities. But technically, this is just an introduction because some of the line items in liabilities will be discussed further in our next lesson, in our next session. So hopefully, after this video, after this session, we will have an understanding of the concept of liabilities. We will be able to describe the nature and type of current and non-current liabilities. We will also know the measurement of the current and non-current liabilities. We will be able to explain the issue of long-term debt falling due within 1 year. To explain also the issue of breach of covenants attached to a long-term debt, and to describe formulas in how to compute bonuses to officers and employees. Under the revised conceptual framework for financial reporting, it provides the following definition of what is a liability. Liabilities are being defined as a present obligation of an entity to transfer an economic resources as a result of past events. Accordingly, we can see here that three characteristics are the essential characteristics of a liability, which is it is a present obligation, it arises from past event, and also there is an outflow of resources. So let's talk about first the present obligation. The entity has a present obligation. It means an obligation is a duty or responsibility that an entity has no practical ability to avoid. So in this characteristic class, we can say that there are two types of obligation being indicated here. So the present obligation being referred here may be a legal obligation or a constructive obligation. So when we say legal obligation, these are the obligations which is legally enforceable as a consequence of a binding contract. There is a contract, which means there is an agreement between parties or a statutory requirement being required by the law. So this is normally the case, for example, with accounts payable for goods and services received. Diba kapag nag-order ka or you will ask for a service for a certain company, usually there is a binding contract between these two parties which make an entity obligated to perform the service and also for you who will avail the service to pay that entity who perform the service. Next, the present obligation may also refer to a constructive obligation. So, constructive obligation give rise to liabilities by reason of normal business practice. Ito na yung nakagawian ng business, custom, and a desire to maintain good business relation. So, maintain good business relation ay dahil gusto ko na sa mga susunod na orders ko, bibigyan pa rin ako ulit ng option for credit. Magbabayad ako agad. Magbabayad ako on time. So, those are constructive obligation. Hindi ka naman nire-require. Hindi ka nire-require ng contract. Hindi ka nire-require ng any law. But it is because of your desire, it is a business practice or a custom na nagawa mo na. Next, liabilities arises from past events or there is a there is a connection between the present obligation and a past event. Anong connection ng dalawa? The past events being referred here is the past transaction that the two entity has, which will lead to a present obligation. For example, Nag-deliver ako ng product kay customer A. So, once na na-deliver ko na yung product, that is a past event na, which is also known as an obligating event. So, nag-deliver na ako ng product. Ibig sabihin nun, dahil nag-deliver na ako ng product kay customer A has a present obligation already to me. Kasi, nagawa ko na yung past event, nagawa ko na yung nakapag-deliver na ako ng product. So, this past event will lead to the present obligation. So, right now, customer A is now obligated to me to pay the things that I delivered to him. So, ayun yung connection ni past event at ni present obligation. Dahil kay past event, dahil may ginawa in the past, you are now obligated. You are now have an obligation. Lastly, outflow of resources or transfer of resources. So, dito naman po, class, ang sinasabi natin dito. Dahil may present obligation, kailangan mo magbayad. Anong ibabayad mo? So, these are the economic resources. So, either cash, either transfer of non-cash assets, or a performance of service. So, dahil may obligation ka, may lalabas na resources. There is an outflow of resources. May lalabas na resources from you. Dahil magbabayad ka, babayaran mo yung present obligation mo. So, either cash, money, non-cash assets, or performance of service, ayun yung lalabas dahil may present obligation ka. Ayun yung lalabas dahil magbabayad ka sa obligation mo. Pero please take note, kapag share dividend, baka isipin natin, ay, nag-declare yung company ng share dividend. So, ibig sabihin ba yun? May liability yung company na yun sa akin dahil share dividend? No. Share dividend or stock dividend is not a liability. But it is a part of the equity. Pero sir, paano kung cash dividend or property dividend yung hindi pa nababayaran? So, kung cash dividend payable yan at property dividend payable, that will be considered as liability. Kasi nga, may lalabas na resources. There is an outflow of resources. Ano yung outflow of resources? Cash, saka yung property na matransfer doon sa stockholder. Kapag share dividend kasi, wala namang resources na lumalabas, kundi nag-i-increase lang yung equity. Kaya siya hindi nagiging part ng liability. Okay, so what are some example of liabilities? So we have accounts payable to supplier for the purchase of goods or services. Familiar na kayo dito. Amounts withheld from employees or other parties for taxes and for contribution to government-mandated contributions such as SSS, pag-ibig, PhilHealth. So that is also a liability. Accruals for wages, interest, royalties, taxes, product, warranties, and profit sharing plans. These are also part of liabilities. Dividends, take note, not stock dividends. Declared, but not yet paid. Deposits and advances from customers are also example of liabilities. Debt obligations for borrowed funds such as notes, mortgage, and bonds payable, they are also example of liabilities. Income tax payable and unearned revenue, they are example of liabilities. So, we have two classifications of liabilities. We have the current and non-current liability. So let's try to differentiate what is a current liability and a non-current liability. So current liabilities under PAS 1, paragraph 69, it provides that an entity shall classify a liability as current when, first, the entity expects to settle the liability within the entity's operating cycle. Second, the entity holds the liability primarily for the purpose of trading. Third, the liability is due to be settled within 12 months after the reporting period. So either within the entity's operating cycle or within 12 months, whichever is shorter. The entity does not have an unconditional right to defer settlement of the liability for at least 12 months after the reporting period. Take note of unconditional right to defer settlement. Wala siyang right to defer settlement. So, ibig sabihin, wala siyang right to extend the payment of the liability for at least 12 months after the reporting period. So, non-current liability naman tayo. When we refer to non-current liability, usually it is a residual definition. So, all liabilities that will not fall under current liability is non-current liability. Ulitin ko ha. Those liability, kaya siya tinawag na residual definition dahil lahat ng liabilities na hindi magpo-fall under the category of current liabilities, then considered it as non-current liabilities. So, non-current liabilities include non-current portion of the long-term debt, finance lease liabilities, deferred tax liability, and long-term obligation to offers. And lastly, long-term deferred revenue. So, kung ang unearned income natin deferred revenue is expected to be realized more than 12 months, then they will fall under non-current liabilities. So, please take note of this following condition also. In order for a liability to be considered as a non-current liability. First, if the refinancing on a long-term basis is completed on or before the end of the reporting period. So, kung yung refinancing ng long-term on a long-term basis na complete siya, so ibig sabihin yung liability mo na kompleto siya on or before the end of reporting period. Sabihin natin 2022 ngayon, natapos or nakompleto yung refinancing on a long-term basis on or before end of the year. So, the refinancing will be adjusted as an obligation classified as non-current. Next, if the entity has the discretion to refinance or roll over an obligation for at least 12 months after the reporting period under an existing loan facility, the obligation is classified as non-current even if it would otherwise be due within a shorter period. So, kung merong discretion to refinance si entity to roll over an obligation for at least 12 months. At least. So, ibig sabihin, lalagpas na yun ng 1 year. After the reporting period under an existing loan, this will be considered as a non-current liability. Next, if the entity has an unconditional right under the existing loan facility to defer settlement of the liability at least 12 months after the reporting period, the obligation will be considered as part of the non-current. Ulitin ko ha, if the entity has an unconditional right to defer settlement, kung meron siya. Also, ayan, let's note that the refinancing or rolling over must be at the discretion of the entity. Kasi kung hindi siya at the discretion of the entity, then hindi mo siya pwedeng i-consider as non-current liability. So, with regards to measurement naman po, the difference between current liabilities and non-current liabilities, current liability usually measured, recorded, and reported at their face amount. So, kung magkano yun, ayun na yun. Kung magkano yung inutang mo, today, siya yung i-reflect mo as current liabilities, amount ng current liabilities mo. However, kapag non-current liabilities naman tayo, such as bonds payable and non-interest-bearing note, they will be measured at its present value. So, di ba kapag usual kapag mga non-current value, non-current liabilities, we compute first the present value of this. And also, subsequent measure of these non-current liabilities will be at amortized cost. Kapag yung notes payable mo naman ay interest-bearing, it is initially and subsequently measured at face amount. So, ayun yung tatandaan natin. Kapag ang note payable mo ay interest-bearing, face amount. So, yung actual na amount niya. No need to compute for the present value. Pero kapag ang notes payable mo ay non-interest-bearing, you need to compute for the present value of these notes. Okay, so let's talk about covenants. So sometimes, some of the loan, the liabilities that we have are having covenants. So what are covenants? These are often attached to borrowing agreements that represent undertakings by the borrower. So it represents undertakings. So these are some rules with regard to your credit. Kung naka-encounter na kayo ng mga loan, mag-apply ng loan, usually, there are terms and conditions. So, these terms and conditions, these are covenants. So, parang ang covenants ay some restriction to the borrower. So, paano kung si borrower na-breach na yung covenants? Ibig sabihin yung mga restriction doon sa covenants, doon sa undertaking ni borrower, nilabag niya, hindi niya nasunod. So, under these covenants, if certain conditions relating to the borrower's financial situation are breached, the liability becomes payable on demand. So, for example, long-term liability to, non-current liability. Tapos, yung non-current liability na yun, diba, for example, maturity date niya ay after 5 years pa. Pero dahil nilabag mo yung covenants, hindi mo nasunod yung covenants mo, the liability will become payable on demand kahit na non-current pa yan. So, ibig sabihin nun, that liability will be considered as a current liability already. However, the liability can still be classified as non-current if the lender has agreed on or before at the end of the reporting period to provide a grace period. So, kung meron na pagkasunduan na grace period, then pwede pa natin siyang i-consider as non-current as long as it happens on or before the end of the reporting period, ending at least 12 months after that date. Okay. What is a grace period? Sabi po dito, a grace period is a period within which the entity can rectify the breach and during which the lender cannot demand immediate repayment. So, kung may grace period, hindi pwedeng mag-demand for payment si lender. So, now let's talk about the presentation of current liability. So, under paragraph 54 of PAS 1, in our statement of financial position, as a minimum, it will include the following line items for the current liability. First, trade and other payables such as the notes payable, current provisions, short-term borrowing, current portion of long-term debt and the current tax liability. Okay, so let's talk now about the estimated liabilities. Sir, paano yung mga liabilities na hindi man natin alam kung magkano, hindi natin alam kung kailan yung maturity date. These are called estimated liabilities. So, estimated liabilities are obligations that exist at the end of reporting period. Alam natin na meron tayong liabilities na to. Pero, hindi nga lang natin alam kung magkano siya. Hindi tayo ganun ka-sure kung magkano siya. And also, hindi natin alam kung gaano katagal siya dapat bayaran. So, estimated liabilities are either current or non-current in nature. So, example of these liabilities are estimated liability for premiums, award points, warranties, gift certificates, and bonus. So, yung computation for premiums, we will discuss it on the next chapter. So, hindi po natin siya i-discuss right now. Okay, so next, deferred revenue or unearned revenue. We are already familiar with this. Nadi-discuss to in your accounting one during your senior high school. So, deferred revenue or unearned revenue are income already received but not yet earned. So, ibig sabihin, binayaran ka in advance ng customer mo, pero hindi mo pa nagagawa kung ano yung man yung pinapagawa ng customer mo. Deferred revenue. So, deferred revenue may be realizable within 1 year or in more than 1 year after the end of the reporting period. So, either current na naman to or non-current. So, kapag the deferred revenue is realizable within 1 year, that is current liability. But if your deferred revenue is realizable more than 1 year after the end of the reporting period, then it will be considered as a non-current liability. So, typical examples of current deferred revenue are unearned interest income, unearned rental income, and unearned subscription revenue. Typical examples naman po ng non-current deferred revenue are unearned revenue from long-term service contracts and long-term leasehold advances. Okay, so let's have some illustration for deferred revenues. An entity sells equipment service contracts agreeing to service equipment for a 2-year period. Cash receipts from contracts are credited to unearned service revenue, and service contract costs are charged to service contract expenses. Revenue from service contract is recognized as earned over the service period of the contracts. So, the following transactions occur in the first year. We have cash receipts from contract sold. Which is 1 million. So, ito, yung na-receive natin, pero wala pa naman tayo nagagawa. This will be considered as unearned revenue. Next, service contract cost paid. Sabi po, any service contract cost will be charged to service contract expenses. And lastly, service contract revenue recognized 800,000. So ito na mismo yung service revenue mo. So how we will journalize this transaction? So this will be the journal entries for those transactions. First, to record the cash receipts from service contract sold, cash debit, may na-receive kang pera. Credit, unearned service revenue. Bakit credit ang unearned service revenue? Dahil ang unearned revenue ay isang liability amounting to 1 million pesos. To record the service contract cost paid. So, dahil service contract cost, this is an expense. That's why we will debit the expense, which is the service contract expense, amounting to 500,000. And dahil nagbayad tayo, tayo yung nagbayad, yung company yung nagbayad, we will credit cash amounting to 500,000. Next, to record the service contract revenue recognized, yung kinita mo na. So, dahil nag-record ka na dito ng, nag-credit ka ng unearned service revenue, kapag kinita mo na yan, babaliktarin mo siya. Kung nakakredit siya, ide-debit mo na siya. That's why we debit the unearned service revenue. Next, magka-credit na tayo ng revenue. Dahil kinita mo na siya, amounting to 800,000. So, question. Kapag ang tinatanong sa problem is, what is the amount of the unearned service revenue at the end of the year? Ang sagot ba ay 1,800,000 o 200,000? Pipili lang tayo naman, pipili lang tayo diyan sa tatlong 'yan. 1 million ba? 800,000 or 200,000? So ang tamang sagot ay 200,000. Tinatanong kasi ay magkano na lang yung unearned service revenue at the end of the year. Kung nung umpisa, meron kang unearned service revenue na credit 1 million, pero nabawasan na siya ng 800,000. Kung makita niyo sa number 3, nag-debit tayo ng unearned service revenue. So, ang balance na lang ng unearned service revenue mo ay 200,000. Another question, what will be the amount of our service contract revenue for the year? 800,000. What is the amount of expense, service contract expense? 500,000. Kung ito lang yung transaction ng company, at ang tanong, what will be the net income of the company? We simply deduct the revenue and expenses. 800 minus 500,000. So at the end of the year, meron kang 300,000 na income. Kung ito lang yung transaction ni company, ha? Okay, so next, let's have gift certificates payable. So minsan, yung mga mega malls, department stores, and supermarkets, they sell gift certificates. Kung naka-receive na kayo ng mga gift certificates, so binibenta yan ni mega mall, department stores, at ni supermarket. So, kapag ganito yung transaction, or kapag nabibenta si mega mall, si yung mga malls ng gift certificates, this will be some of the accounting procedures that we follow when we are recording that transaction. For example, kapag nakapagbenta ka ng gift certificates, when the gift certificates are sold, ang entry natin, debit cash, credit gift certificates payable. So kung mapapansin nyo, no, hindi agad siya ni-recognize as sales. Sir, kailan natin siya ma-recognize as sales? When these gift certificates are already redeemed. So, ang magiging entry natin dyan, kapag claim na ng pinagbigyan ng gift certificate, yung gift certificate niya dun sa mall, dun pa lang yung time na ma-receive mo or ma-recognize mo as sales yung gift certificates na nabenta mo. So, sa unang transaction, kapag nagbenta ka pala ng gift certificates, payable pa siya, liability pa siya. Pero once na na-redeem na yung gift certificates na yun, then, ayun pa lang yung time na magiging sales siya. So, ang entry natin dyan, debit gift certificates payable, babawasan na natin yung gift certificates natin, credit sales. Paano naman kung nag-expire na or yung gift certificate ay hindi na redeem. So, ang entry po natin dyan, bawasan ulit yung payable kasi hindi na mare-redeem. So, debit gift certificates payable and credit forfeited gifts certificate. Pero, plus, please take note that gift certificates are no longer subjects to an expiration period. Ito ay nanggaling sa Department of Trade and Industry. So, the gift certificates no longer have an expiration period. So, medyo hindi na natin magamit yung journal entry number 3 dito. Na kapag nag-expired yung gift certificates. Magamit na lang natin yan kung nabasa, nasira yung gift certificates. So, hindi na pwedeng i-redeem ni customer yon. So, pwede natin gamitin to. Pero when it comes to expiration, hindi natin magamit itong entry na to kasi they don't have expiration date. So, next, ito naman po sa bonus. Large entities often compensate key officers and employees by way of bonus per superior income realized during the year. So, kapag na-reach natin yung quota sa company, usually yung mga big boss natin, magbibigay sila ng bonus sa mga employees or sa officers. The main purpose of this scheme is to motivate the officers and employees to work hard para ma-reach. So, this compensation plan results in liability that must be measured and reported in the financial statement. So, the bonus computation usually has four variations. First, we have bonus is expressed as a 13% of income before bonus and before tax. The second one, after bonus but before tax. The third one, after bonus and after tax. The fourth one is after tax but before bonus. So, paano natin isosolve yan? Let's have some example. Okay. So, first scenario natin, before bonus and before tax. So, the income before bonus and before tax is 4,400,000. Bonus is 10%, income tax rate is 30%. So, before bonus and before tax. So, how do we compute for bonus? So, simple lang po yan. Bonus is equals to 10% multiplied by the given na kasi yung income before bonus and before tax. So, 10% times 4,400,000. So, your bonus will be 4 times 0.10 is 440,000. So, simple lang. Walang paligoy-ligoy kapag before bonus and before tax. So, you simply multiply the income before bonus and before tax by the bonus rate, which is 10%. So, next natin is after bonus but before tax. So, same details. Magkakaiba lang po ito pagdating sa formula. So, ang mangyayari po dito, so, ang bonus natin is 10% of the income before bonus and before tax minus, kasi sabi dito after bonus. So, kung after bonus siya, itong 4,400,000, ima-minus mo dyan yung bonus. Pero sa scenario kasi na to, hindi pa natin identify kung magkano yung bonus. Ayun yung ide-derive natin. So, ang mangyayari po, 10% times 4,400,000, bonus is equals to 440,000 minus 10% times B. So, 0.10B. So B plus 0.10 B equals to 440,000. So this will be 1.10 B equals to 440,000. So para makancel yung 1.10 dito, divide natin by 1.10. And also this will be divided by 1.10. So matitira na lang natin dito ay bonus equals to 440 divided by 1.10, which is 400,000. So, ganyan po kapag after bonus but before tax. So, ibig sabihin, pag sinabing after, kailangan sa formula na to, i-deduct mo si kung ano man yung after na yun. So, minus B. Okay, so next scenario tayo. After bonus and after tax. So, ang magiging formula natin dito is bonus equals 0.10 multiply by the income pero ito kasi after bonus so minus B minus T so minus B minus T pero plus take note also that T is equals to income minus B multiplied by 30%. So, itong T na to, makakuha natin yung T kapag minultiply natin ng 30%, which is the income tax rate, yung 4,400,000 less bonus. So, i-integrate natin yan dito sa formula natin. Kaya, ang magiging formula natin is 0.10 multiplied by 4,400,000 minus B minus, i-include na natin itong tax natin, 0.30 multiplied by 4,400,000 minus B. So, simplify pa ulit natin. So, 0.10 4,400,000 minus B minus 0.30 times 4,400,000 1,320,000 minus 0.30 B. Then, yan, distribute na natin itong 0.10. 4,400,000 times 0.10, we have 440,000. Then, 0.10 multiplied by negative B, we have negative 0.10 B. 0.10, a class this will be positive pala. Kasi negative times negative. So, 0.10 times negative 1,320,000. This will be 132,000. Plus, 0.10 multiplied by 0.3. So, you will have 0.03. B. Then, i-simplify pa ulit natin. B equals to 440 minus 132. So we have 308,000. Then negative 0.10 times negative 0.10 plus 0.03. We have 0.07. Okay. Then transpose natin. So B plus 0.07B equals to 308,000. Then this will be 1.07B equals to 308,000. So divide natin ng 1.07 para makuha natin yung bonus. So 308,000 divided by 1.07, we will have ang bonus natin, dito ko na lang ilagay sa taas, 287,850.47. Okay, so next scenario tayo. After tax but before bonus. So dito, ang magiging formula natin, bonus is equals to bonus rate 0.10 multiplied by income less tax. Kasi after tax before bonus. So let's take note ulit that tax is equals to .30% or 0.30 multiplied by 4,400,000 minus bonus. So if we will integrate it sa formula natin ng bonus, so bonus is equals to 0.10 multiplied by 4,400,000 minus yung formula natin sa tax, 0.3 multiplied by 4,400,000 minus bonus. So simplify pa natin, 0.10, 4,400,000 minus 0.3 times 440. 0.3 times 4,400,000. We have 1,320,000. Then negative 0.3 times negative B. We have positive 0.30B. So simplify pa ulit natin. 0.10 times 4,400,000, meron kang 440,000. 0.10 minus multiply by negative 1,320,000, meron kang negative 132,000. 0.10 times 0.3, meron kang 0.03B. Then 440 minus 132, meron kang 308,000. Plus 0.03. So transpose natin yon. B minus minus 0.03 P equals to 308,000. So this will be 0.97 B equals to 308,000. Divide natin ng 0.97 para makancel yung 0.97 dito. So 308,000 divided by 0.97, ang bonus natin ay 317,525.77. Okay, so let's talk about refundable deposits naman po. So, refundable deposits consist of cash or property received from customers but which are refundable after compliance with certain conditions. So, pinaka-example natin dito, kapag bumili ka ng Coke, yung, sabihin natin yung may bote ng Coke. Tapos, yung minsan kasi, hindi pinapadala ng mga binibilhan natin yung bote, di ba? Or, magbabayad ka ng deposito. So, those deposits are considered as refundable deposit. Kasi, once na sinoli mo na, ibabalik na sa iyo yung binayad mo na deposit. So, illustration natin dito, a deposit of 10,000 is required from the customer for returnable containers. The containers cost 8,000. So, how do we entry it? So, debit cash, 10,000 yung magkano yung binayaran deposit. Even though 8,000 yung cost ng containers, pero ang deposit, ang refundable deposit ay 10,000. So, yung 10,000 yung ire-record mo. So, debit cash, 10,000. Credit, containers deposit amounting to 10,000. Ito ay para sa containers deposit, ha? Bukod yung entry natin dyan sa mismo container kung binili natin. Pero dito kasi, nirerentahan natin for yung mga containers. So, the containers deposit account is usually classified as current liability. So, kung meron ko containers deposit sa mga account title nyo at may amount, that will be considered as current liability. If the customer returns the containers, the deposit is simply refunded. So, ibabalik lang yung amount na binayaran. However, kung hindi na nabalik yung mga containers na yon, the deposit will be considered as the sales price of the containers. The excess of the deposit over the cost of the containers is considered as a gain. So, kung hindi na nabalik, that will be a sale sa atin na. Kung hindi nabalik yung mga container na 10,000 pesos, that container deposit will be considered as the sale price of the containers na binenta natin, even though na cost niya ay 8,000. Okay, so let's have some problem. So, on December 31, ito ay mga illustration ng problem solving para in case sa mga exam natin, medyo marunong na tayo. So, on December 31, 2020, Glare Company provided the following information. Accounts payable including deposits and advances from customers of 250,000. Notes payable including note payable to bank due on December 31, 2022, amounting to 500,000. Share dividend payable 400,000. Credit balance in customer's account 200,000. Serial bonds payable in semi-annual installment of 500,000. Amounting to, ang total niya, 5 million. Accrued interest on bonds payable, 150,000. Contested BIR tax assessment, possible obligation, 300,000. Unearned rent income, 100,000. So, ang question dito, hindi ko na ilagay. What will be the amount of current liability as of 2020. So, titingnan natin dito, ano ba yung mga part ng current liabilities natin. First, accounts payable which include deposits and advance from customer of 2,250,000. So, sinabi niya lang na yung 250,000 yan ay deposits and advances from customer. Pero, the total amount will all fall under current liability. Notes payable including note payable to bank due on December 31, 2022 of 500,000. So, yung 500,000 dito sa 1,500,000, ang due date niya 2022, 2 years. So, hindi siya kasama sa current liabilities natin. So, yung 500,000 na yan, i-minus mo sa 1,500,000. So, ang isasama lang natin sa current liabilities natin ay 1 million lang. Next, share dividend payable. Ano sinabi ko kanina? Pag share dividend payable, hindi siya liability. So, hindi siya kasama. Next, credit balances in customer's account. So, ibig sabihin, kung babalikan nyo yung trial balance ng accounts receivable, naka-credit yung balance ng accounts receivable. Kapag naka-credit yung balance ng accounts receivable, ibig sabihin may overpayment si customer. So, kapag may overpayment si customer's account, si customer, ibig sabihin nun, these are some advances from customer. So, itong 200,000 na to, kasama pa rin. Serial bonds payable in semi-annual installment of 500,000. So, ibig sabihin, serial bonds payable, nagmamature yan every year. Or, sa scenario na to, semi-annual installment. So, ibig sabihin, for next year, for 2021, may mag-due dyan na semi-annual to, ah, dalawang 500,000. May magmamature sa bonds payable mo ng dalawa, which is 500,000 each. So, ibig sabihin, kung magmamature sila next year, 2021, that will be considered as current liability. So, dito, out of the 5 million, 1 million yan ay current liability. Next, accrued interest. Accrued interest, accruals are always considered as current liability. Ito, possible obligation. Pag possible obligation, hindi pa natin siya isasama. Next, unearned rent income, deferred income, kapag silent siya, dito unearned rent income, na-classify natin siya as kanina as current liabilities. Doon sa mga example na binigay natin. So, kasama siya. So, 1,250,000 plus 1,000,000 plus 200,000 plus 1,000,000 plus 150,000 plus 100,000, then you will have 3,700,000. Okay, so next So, another set of problem tayo. Easy Company provided the following information on December 31, 2020. Notes payable, trade 3 million, bank loans 2 million, advances from officer 500,000, accounts payable, trade 4 million, bank overdraft 300,000, dividends payable 1 million, withholding tax 100,000, mortgage payable 3,800,000, income tax payable 800,000, estimated warranty liability 600,000, estimated damages payable by reason of breach of contract 700,000, accrued liabilities 900,000, estimated premium liability 200,000, claim for increase in wages 3,500,000, and contract entered into for the construction of building 5 million. So, unahin natin Ang tinatanong dito, current liabilities. So, all the notes payable, they will be part of the current liabilities. The accounts payable, bank overdraft, ang bank overdraft, this is the negative balance of your cash in bank. So, kung nag-negative balance siya, that will be part of our current liability. Dividends payable, hindi naman sinabi na share dividend to, so 1 million, that will be part of our current liability. Withholding tax payable, mortgage payable are usually part of the non-current liability. Income tax payable, current po lagi yan. Estimated warranty liability, that will be part of your current liability. Estimated damage payable by reason of breach of contract. Ito yung kanina, yung breach of covenant. So, kung nag-breach ka ng contract, that will be automatically magiging part ng current liability mo. Next, accrued liabilities, current liabilities yan. Estimated premium liability, current liability din yan. Claim for increase in wages by employees covered in a pending lawsuit. Pending pa lang. So, wala pa yan. Then, contract entered into for the construction of building. Contract pa lang yan. Wala ka pang nagagawa. Wala pang past event. So, wala pang present obligation. Okay, so, let's add 3 million plus 2 million plus 500 plus 4 million plus 300 plus 1 million plus 100 plus 800 plus 600 plus 700 plus 900 plus 200. So, our answer is 14,100,000. Okay, so next problem tayo. Okay, so next problem tayo. On December 31, 2020, Cordillera Company reported the following liabilities. Note payable 9%, 3 million. Note payable 8%, 6 million. Note payable 10%, 4 million. Note payable 11%, 5 million. So, lahat to ay interest bearing. So, nire-report natin siya at its face amount. So, then, ito yung mga ilang details about this note payable. The 9% note payable is non-cancelable and matures on July 31, 2021. Sufficient cash is expected to be available to retire the note at maturity. The 8% note payable matures on May 31, 2026, but the creditor has the option of calling the note or demanding payment on June 30, 2021. However, the call option is not expected to be exercised given the prevailing market condition. Next, the 10% notes payable is due on March 31, 2022. A debt covenant requires Cordillera Company to maintain current asset at least equal to 150% of current liabilities. On December 31, 2020, Cordillera Company is in violation of this covenant. So, nag-violate siya ng covenant. However, Cordillera Company obtained a waiver from the creditor until June 2021, having convinced the creditor that Cordillera's normal 2-to-1 ratio of current assets to current liabilities will be reestablished during the first half of 2021. So, nagkaroon ng grace period. Next, the 11% note payable matures on June 30, 2021, on January 31, 2021, before the issuance of the 2020 financial statements. The note payable was refinanced on a long-term basis. So, explain the appropriate classification of the notes payable as current or non-current in the statement of financial position on December 31, 2020. So, dito identify natin, dito sa apat na to, ano dyan yung mga magpo-fall under current liability, magpo-fall under non-current liability. Okay, so yung una, yung 3 million, notes payable of 9%. So, this notes payable will be considered as a current liability. Why? Because it is payable in the upcoming year. Diba? Payable. Kailan siya maging payable? July 31, 2021. Thus, kung magpo-fall na siya, kung mag-due na siya next year, then, it can be considered as current liability. So, the note payable, 9%, 3 million, current liability yan. Kasi mag-due na siya next year. And there is no refinance with long-term obligation. Second, the notes payable 8% with 6 million value. This will be considered as a current liability also. The requirement to reclassify currently maturing debt as a current liability includes debt that is callable by the creditor in the upcoming year, even if the debt is not expected to be called. Kung mapapansin nyo, there is a call option for the creditor on the next year. That's why it will fall as a current liability. Kahit na it will not be expected to be called by the creditor. The third one, note payable 10%, 4 million, it will be considered as non-current liability. Even if na nagkaroon ng violation sa covenant, nakakuha naman ng grace period si Cordillera Company. So, dahil may grace period, nakakuha ng grace period si Cordillera Company. Sabi nga dito, di ba, kanina dapat 12 months, pero dito 6 months lang. Mababayaran na din niya. So, dahil nakakuha ng grace period si Cordillera Company, that liability will be considered as non-current. Di ba ang rule natin kanina, kapag nag-breach ng covenant, current liability automatic yon. Pero kapag nakakuha ng grace period, within 12 months after the reporting period, it will still fall under non-current liability. Next, the notes payable 11%, 5 million. This will be considered as current liability. The note payable will be refinanced on a long-term basis on January 31, 2021. Diba? Ang end ng term nito, 2020, so December 31. Ang rule natin kanini dito, para ma-consider siya as non-current liability, dapat on or before the reporting period. Eh, ma-refinance to January 31, 2021 na. So, after the reporting period na. That's why it will fall under current liability itong notes payable na to. Okay, so that will be the end of our discussion. If you have any question about what I have discussed for today, you can message me either in email, messenger, or through Canvas. So for the exercises, the assignment exercise that I have uploaded in the Canvas, this will be due on Tuesday before our session. Synchronous session. And in our synchronous session, we will discuss the answer to those problems in the exercise para klaro tayo before tayo mag-move on sa bagong topic. So again, that will be the end of our discussion. Thank you for listening.